Thank you. Guys, if you would put on the screen, we're going a little different direction here by the leading of the Holy Spirit. But if you would take 1 Chronicles chapter 4, please. 1 Chronicles chapter 4 and verse number 9. We looked at verse number 10. But if you would take 1 Chronicles chapter 4, verse number 9. I've shared with you verse number 10, but the Lord showed me something here last night. 1 Chronicles 4, 9. If you'd put that on the screen and keep it up there, please. Now Jabez, how many know when God uses a stranger like he did this prophet the other day, he's got something to say to Encounter Church? I know you get it from me, but sometimes it's good to hear it from someone else. Now Jabez was more honorable than his brothers. Now while we want to walk in humility and not pride, I guess the question is, are you more honorable than your sister? Are you more honorable than your brother? There are people that love to honor servants of God. Then there are people that do not honor the servant of God. There are people that honor God. There are people that dishonor God. But Jabez was more honorable. See, God takes notes, folks. God watches my every move. He watches my every single move. He knows my excuses from the truth. But here it's spelled out and it's clarified and it's distinguished that Jabez was more honorable than his own brothers. Boy, that can start a fight right there. Cain and Abel, first murder in the Bible, two brothers. That can cause jealousy right there. There's a reason why some are more blessed than others. Because some are more honorable. Showing honor. Honor means to give somebody what they want. Not something left over because you didn't want it. Let me just trade it off to somebody else and get it out the way. No, that's why we have goodwill. I'm being serious. I'm not saying this even in reference to me. But Jabez was more honorable than his brothers. So in other words, honor can be seen. Honor can be felt. Honor can be heard. Somebody say heard.
Heard.
Mm-hmm. We're going to talk about a sound today. So Jabez was more honorable than his brothers. He stood out. How many want to stand out?
Yes.
I don't want to stand out as a troublemaker. I don't want to stand out as a gossiper. You know people who are gossipers, right? I instantly run from them. But then there are those that are honorable. And those are the people you want to be with. Those are the people you want to socialize with. Those are the people that will recharge you. Anyone who's dishonorable, hear me, will drain you. Why do we charge our battery? Because it's drained. Why is it drained? Because it's being used. Sometimes if you feel a little drained, that may be a good thing. Paul says, I was spent after I got done preaching. And he said, I was willing to be spent. The greatest thing today I can do is pour myself out of to you until there's nothing left in me. Nothing left. So that he can refill me to the very top. See? But honor is different than just doing something because you have to do it. That's why there are people that honor God's house. And some dishonor. Some people make their rules. Once a week is enough. Some people say, no, I'm more hungry than that. I need twice a week. Some people honor authority, honor our country, honor our family members, honor our loved ones. Pastor Joni and I were at a wedding last night. Our niece got married. Our precious niece got married. And sometimes at weddings and at funerals, stuff happens. But that's the time to show honor, not dishonor. That's the time where if somebody makes fun of you or makes an insult about you, you just shake it off and you don't retaliate. You don't fight against them. You just give them a smile in love when deep inside you want to slap them upside their head. But you show honor. You burn them with honor. Burn with love. But here was Jabez. He was categorized as one who showed honor to authority. He was more honorable than his brothers. Watch this. Talk about power in a name. And his mother called his name Jabez. Now imagine naming your son Pain. Imagine declaring and decreeing that the name of, hey, what's your son's name, Jabez? Oh, really? What does that mean, Pain? And here, based on his name, he did not want to live up to his namesake. That's why many times when I pray, Lord, do it for your namesake. For your namesake. Because a name carries weight. A name carries authority. A name can be something negative or something positive. That's why when I pray the God of Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, I'm not just rattling off names. Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Joseph. I'm speaking about my downline, the power of my DNA, my forefathers in the Lord. But Jabez, of all things, he was honorable. So what's his reward? His mother names him Pain. Which takes us into verse 10. So Jabez called on the God of Israel. He didn't say, woe is me. He didn't say, I'm offended that my mother would call me Pain. But Jabez called on the God of Israel, saying, oh, that you would bless me indeed. Now, the truth is, God was blessing him. But when you're going around with a name called Pain, sometimes you wonder, am I really a blessing? That's why I declare and decree words of life over you. So Jabez called on the God of Israel, saying, oh, that you would bless me indeed and enlarge my territory, that your hand would be with me. Folks, I declare this over you today, that God will enlarge your territory and his hand will be with you. One thing I've noticed all my life, 60 plus years, his hand has been with me. When people have liked what I said or disliked what I said, his hand has been with me. All throughout my life, he branded me. He branded you so that his hand will be with you. But it's important to honor him. The word honor is the Hebrew word kabad, K-A-B-A-D, kabad. It means to give somebody what they really want. To give somebody what they really want. And Jabez was honorable, more honorable than his own brothers. And he said that your hand will be with me. See, he wasn't sure. Because, hear me, he identified himself after the name that his mother gave him. See, you're not really the person who's called you out in the natural. You're not really a Joni or an April or an Eddie or a Charles. That may be something that people identify you with in the natural. But you are a son of God. You are a daughter of God. I ain't a James. I'm a son of God. And when you see yourself as a son of God, when you see yourself as a daughter of God, then you'll identify with who you are in Christ and not who you are in Jim or Joni or Charles or Eddie. Are you following me?
Yes.
That you would keep me from evil. And watch this. That I may not cause pain. I don't think he meant to throw his mother under the bus, but he truly believed. You called me Pain, so I guess I am a pain. But look at this. God granted him what he requested. So now, let's go back to the start of verse number 10. If we would. And if you could, put your device down, whatever it is that you're using to take notes, and just stretch your hands toward me right now. And I declare upon you as an apostle of God, as I declare on you as a child of God in Calna Church, every one of you in this room today, I pray that God would bless you indeed, emphatically. And may he enlarge your sphere of influence, your territory. May you walk in your authority. May you walk in the influence that was ordained from God for you. You are a person of influence. You don't have the mentality of the tail, you're the head. May you walk, and where you walk, may it enlarge. May where you walk enlarge faith. May where you walk enlarge hope. May when you talk to people, enlarge their vision. May your territory where you walk, may the devil have to flee from your children's bedroom, from the family room. May the Lord enlarge, I declare it now, your realm of influence in the marketplace, in the school district, as a mother, as a father, as a child, as a daughter. May he enlarge your realm of influence. May he enlarge your peace. May he use you to enlarge people's hope. May he use you to enlarge people's hope, their vision, their destiny. That no weapon formed against you shall prosper. And that his hand will be on you. That you would not be one that causes pain. Gossipers cause pain. People that withhold back more than what is right causes pain. People that don't show honor causes pain. But I declare the blessings of Jabez upon your life in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit in Jesus' name. I release it. The recharge of the spirit of Jabez. Where you may have felt one way, I'm inadequate, I'm not worthy, I don't have a soulmate, I don't have a partner, I don't have a husband, I don't have this, no. May the Lord enlarge your creativity. May he enlarge your revelation. May he enlarge your honorability. That you stand out. Not because you're looking to be seen or heard. It's just something that honor does. It releases favor. May favor drip from you. May it drip. May favor rain. Rain. Santo de Boku Santo. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Woo. Wow. Wow. Yes, Lord. 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 Masando la bocuta da bolsa. Ate que la bol santo. That was not a Jimmy blessing. That was an apostolic, prophetic, heavenly blessing. Heaven is coming down. Heaven is coming down. Wow. I had to release that. Before I can go any further, I had to release that. It's yours. It's yours. It's yours. Child of the King. We inflict pain on the enemy. Not on each other. Not on God's house, but on the devil's house. Not on God's kingdom, but the devil's kingdom. We release. Mata Kepo Santo. Whew. That anointing makes you feel strong. Authoritative. Thank you, Lord. Bless your wonderful name, Jesus. Whew, if you can, be seated if you can. Continuation of acceleration. I had to let that out. I couldn't go anymore. This may sound funny, but you know this. I talk your language. Sometimes I have something really important to tell my wife, and her body will go in a certain position. I know what that means. She's got to go to the bathroom. So I'll wait. And after she releases, then tell me anything you want, and vice versa. Sometime you can't wait for the end of the service to release. I love you too much. I could not wait. Sometimes we'll do it at the end, but today, something came on me, the Holy Ghost. Somebody say a continuation of acceleration. Come on, shout recharge. Aren't you glad that God does not reject? A few years ago, all these R words, we could preach a series of messages on any one of these words. Restore. Wow. Here's one in itself. Years ago, I did a study on the word restoration. And I found a verse in every book of the Bible on restoration, to restore. Regroup. Sometimes we need to regroup. Redeem. Rebound. Every one of these R words fit into our lives at one point or another. Rebuild, repair, refresh, renew. I almost feel guilty just going over them so quickly, but I got to do it because it's taken us to where I really need to take you. Regain. Somebody say regain.
Regain.
Yeah. Rejuvenate. Reward. Relax. Rest. Rescue. Relief. Renovate. Relaunching. And there's more. The recharge. You know, again, I can't help but think of that cell phone of mine. And the more I use it, the more I have to plug that thing in. I don't like seeing 10%. And here's what I noticed about my cell phone, maybe yours as well. When it's down to 10% and down to 5%, it's as good as gone. Why is it that it goes from 10 to 5 just like that? And it doesn't go from 5 to 4. I mean, it says it numerically, but it's like, it's really just zap. You got to stay plugged in. All the apps that God's given you, the app of joy, the app of peace, the app of soul winning, the app of wisdom, the app of discernment, and they're all in there. But so long as we remain plugged in, all those apps can work. That's our daily bread. That's our daily bread. Now, since we started, and it's still new, this word recharge, and you've been hearing it about the last couple weeks, with or without me, I've been seeing things on Facebook, reading things, and people sharing. And I have some photos that some of you already seen, but I have a couple more to add to them. So let's show on the screen, guys, some of these recharging words and what people are saying. Let's do that, guys. Keep your spiritual batteries recharged. Now, guys, this is after God showed me this word on recharged. Now, of course, he didn't show it to me first. I'm sure it's been out there first. There's nothing new under the sun. But here, keep your spiritual batteries recharged. There it is, a confirmation. Say confirmation.
Confirmation.
Let's see another one. Charging your spiritual battery. So God is speaking to the body of Christ about recharge. Let's share another one. Needing a recharge. I know who that is. That's Pastor Greg Laurie in California. Needing a recharge. So I believe the Lord's trying to tell the church it's time to get plugged in and stay plugged in. Can I get a witness?
Amen.
Mm-hmm. Because if we're not plugged in, all those apps, man, they look pretty, but they're useless. Another one there? 7 ways to recharge your prayer life in 2018. It's amazing. You know, when people are prophetic, they catch things by the realm of the Spirit. And I believe we have a couple more to add to that. Let's see. Since I saw you. Look at that. Isn't that cool? Isn't that really cool? I like that. Recharge. And I believe there's one more here. Yeah, recharge your spiritual battery. So it's very obvious that God is showing us the importance of recharge. Is that right?
Yes.
As I told you a couple weeks back, it's like Ezekiel the prophet, when he prophesied about the, in Ezekiel 47, about the ankles, the rivers of God, starting with the ankles, and then coming up to the knees, and to the waist, and to the too deep. It's like 25% and 50% and 75% and 100%. Let me tell you something. The tactics of the devil in these last days requires the body of Christ to be 100% recharged. But when God recharges you with his anointing, when he recharges you with his anointing, it's not 25, it's not 50, it's 100%, so that we may accomplish 100% of what God's ordained for us. The ankles is like 25%. The knees is like 50%. The waist is 75%. To too deep is 100%. Can I get a witness?
Amen.
He recharges our hearts, spirit, soul, and body. Isaiah 40, 31 says, "They that wait upon the Lord shall have their strength renewed." That's a recharge. Say recharge. But you say, why aren't I recharged? You got to wait upon the Lord. You can't wait upon yourself. You got to wait upon the Lord. How do I get recharged? Psalm 46, verse 10. Psalm 46, verse 10. Be still. One of the most difficult things to be and to do, to be still. That word still in the Hebrew is raphabi, which means to relinquish yourself of yourself and depend totally on God. That's how we get recharged, waiting on the Lord, resting in the Lord by being still, silent in the presence of God. In Jude, verse 20, there's only one chapter in the book of Jude. But in Jude, verse 20, it says, "But you, beloved," say that's me.
That's me.
No, really, say it.
That's me.
But really mean it. Okay, so you, what? Building yourselves up, that's a recharge. On your most holy faith, how? Praying in the Holy Spirit. You don't know how many times I can share with you stories after stories that I've been fighting something, I've been fighting a situation in my mind or this or that, or the devil would try to lie or do something. And when you pray in the Spirit, praying in other tongues, it recharges your spirit. The real you. Say, the real me. Recharging in worship, John 4:23. I call this TWA, like the old airlines. TWA, true worshipers arising. This is how we get recharged. Not only praying in the Holy Ghost, but the hour is coming and now is when the true worshipers, not any worshipers, not the noisemakers, but the kingdom shakers, true worshipers will arise. The Father, they will worship the Father in spirit and in truth, for the Father is seeking such to worship him. True worshipers arise. When you worship God with all of your heart, he recharges you and he takes you higher to a new place in him. Can I get a witness?
Amen.
Romans 10:17. God's word recharges your faith. So then faith comes by hearing. And hearing by the word of God. The actual translation to Romans 10:17 says, faith comes by hearing and hearing and hearing and hearing and hearing. Hearing God's word recharges your faith. Recharges your faith. God wants to recharge your anointing. Psalm 92 verse 10. Psalm 92 verse 10. He wants to recharge your anointing. But my horn you have exalted like a wild ox. I have been anointed with fresh oil. Folks, the reason why I am the way I am with this passion, it's not because I'm from New York City or I'm Italian or because I'm 21 years young. It has nothing to do with it. 60, but I feel like 21. Acceleration. But this wild ox anointing, every time you wake up in the morning, Lord, fill me with a fresh anointing. For what this day holds, I do not know, but you know. But equip me, Lord, with a fresh anointing. Not just when I preach, not just this Friday night when we go out and minister. Every day. Say every day. And sometimes it's like a wild ox anointing. It really is. All right. Psalm 42, verse 7. Deep calls unto deep. Deep calls unto deep at the noise of your waterfalls. All your waves and billows have gone over me. That's recharge. Where deep, capital D, deep is the Holy Spirit. Small d, deep is you. Where the Holy Spirit just keeps hovering over you like waves and waves. He recharges you, the Holy Spirit does. And then there's 1 Thessalonians 5:17. It says, pray without ceasing. Pray without ceasing. The more I pray, the more I'm recharged. Are you getting this?
Yes.
Okay. Let me give you some new stuff. New stuff meaning new to this message. But it's been in the Bible for thousands of years. In Romans chapter 12, let's look at Romans chapter 12. I love this. In verse number 10. Romans 12, verse 10, I have not shared this with you regarding our prophetic word for 2018, a continuation of acceleration, recharge. Watch this. Be kindly affectionate to one another with brotherly love. That word love there is agape, which is the brother and sister in Christ love. Be kindly affectionate to one another. To show affection means you're going to go out of your way to look after your sister. You're going to go out of your way to look after your brother. To be affectionate means that you're going to put yourself in the back of the line and you're going to put so-and-so in front of the line. Amen. Be kindly affectionate to one another with what? Brotherly love. Here's that word honor. Like Jabez, he honored more than his other brothers. In honor, giving preference to one another. Not, why did they sit me near the kitchen during that wedding? Why was I table number 26 and not table number 2? No. Be thankful you were invited. Oh, flesh stinks, doesn't it? You could put your fingers over your nostrils right now. You know flesh stinks. Come on, somebody. But the Bible says, honor those around you. Prefer those around you. But I'm tired. Folks, you know how drained I am after service? But my job is not to please me. My job is to please the one who called me. And to do my best. To give my best. To give my all. That's what honor does. Giving preference to one another. Now look at verse 11. You're going to like this one a lot. Not lagging. Slothful, lazy, not lagging in diligence, fervent in spirit, serving one another. The word fervent means passion, fire, zeal. I'm telling you, when you hear me, when you honor your brother in the Lord, when you honor your sister in the Lord, God will put a recharge of zeal, fire, passion within you. That it doesn't, listen, oh my God, I don't know, but look at me, please. Look at me with that little spiritual face of yours. Don't tell me there's never been a time that you never had a negative thought about Apostle Jim DePalma. Just tell me when it's safe.
It's safe.
No, it wasn't convincing.
It's safe.
I would go on to believe that maybe some of you have said something behind my back. That's humanity. Thoughts come. People thought things about Jesus. But the Bible says, when you honor your brother and your sister, and I know you all love me, of course you do, and I love you. But when you honor each other in the love of God, You're not going to be lagging in diligence. You're going to be fervent in spirit, serving the Lord. Again, recharge causes passion to rise up to another level, to where no matter what anybody says against you, you're going to love them anyway. Your attitude toward them is going to be like you're on fire for God, like anybody else. But zeal, somebody say zeal.
Zeal.
Yeah, that's what fervent means, to have a zeal. And I'm telling you what, church, when we honor the Lord, when we honor each other, God will recharge us to where our passion is like brand new every day. I'm telling you, I know what I'm talking about. Fire and zeal. Not lagging in diligence. Look at me, see, some people, when they walk sometimes, you know, and they may be dealing with an issue and it's like their body's dragging or something like that. And, you know, how many know for a long time that happened to me? You know, with my knees, I was like dragging and dragging. But, you know, while I'm dragging, I'm still going to get there. But how many know in the realm of the Spirit, you don't have to drag your way into the blessings of God. You can step in. You could just step in, step in, step in. Listen, you don't have to drag your feet in blessing somebody. Come on, somebody now. You don't have to drag your feet to come to God's house. You don't have to drag your feet to get into God's word. You don't have to drag your feet to say, Lord, this is the day the Lord has made. Sometimes we feel that way in the natural, but when you allow the honor of God to come upon you where you honor Him and honor each other, He'll put a, why am I still preaching after all these years? Why is my intensity level only increasing? Because I've tapped into something called recharge. So no matter what people may say about me or people may say about you or anything, you can stay recharged and keep going and keep going and going and going and going. And you don't have to lag. Excuse me. You don't have to lag, but you can be fervent in spirit, serving the Lord. And look at verse number 12. Rejoicing in hope. In other words, we all sometimes get discouraged. But when you're recharged, you will rejoice in hope. Watch this. Patient in tribulation. Don't get quiet on me now. I said patient in tribulation. I said don't get quiet on me now. But you don't know what I'm going through. Recharge says it's okay. I plugged it in. It's going to lay there. It's going to sit there. I'm going to rest in God. But He's going to refill me even when I feel empty and dormant. He's still recharging me. Rejoicing in hope, patient in tribulation. Watch this. Continuing. Somebody say continuing.
Continuing.
Continuing. That's what recharge does. Recharge doesn't quit. Recharge doesn't give up. But you continue and you continue and you continue till you make it to the finish line. Steadfast in prayer. So these are some of the things that recharge does to the glory of God. And yes, sometimes the enemy, he'll try to come in the way. We talked about the three heavens, the heaven, the third heaven where God rests and resides and Jesus sits at the right hand of God. Then there's a second heaven called the firmament, and there is this earth which was meant to be heaven. But how many know that God can take what the enemy meant for evil in the second heavens? You see, the Bible tells us, and you know this, it says that when Satan was kicked out of heaven, he was thrown to this earth. And the Bible says he goes around this earth seeking whom he may devour. So he is trying to take residence over this heaven on earth. But his main headquarters is not just roaming the earth. His main headquarters is the second heaven. Now, God did not create the second heaven for the devil. God created the second heaven for you to enjoy, to look up into the sky, the new moon, the half moon, the partial moon, the stars, and enjoy His handiwork. But the Bible says that Satan not only roams this earth seeking whom he may devour, but the Bible calls him the prince and power of the air. In fact, in Ephesians chapter 2, verse number 2, in Ephesians chapter 2, verse number 2, it says, "For which you once walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince and power of the air." heir. The Spirit who now works in the sons of disobedience. So we see here that Satan not only roams this earth, this heaven, or what was meant to be heaven, but he roams the atmospheric realm. We see it right here in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 2. Now, I've prophesied these words to you, but now I'm giving you the addresses to these prophecies. I'm giving you the address to these prophecies, and there it is. Ephesians chapter 2, verse number 2. He's known as the prince and power of the air. And then if you'll see Ephesians chapter 6, Ephesians chapter 6, verse number 12. Ephesians 6, verse 12. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against rulers of darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness, where? In the heavenlies. So there, hear me, folks. There's a war. This is so true, guys. There's a war that's taking place in the heavenlies. There's a war. And the prayers from heaven, number one, thy kingdom come, thy will be done. Thy kingdom is residing within me, Lord. You ordained this earth to be heaven, but now heaven reigns in me. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. Greater is he that is in me. But now sometimes, as I'm trying to penetrate into God's realm, into heaven, that heaven called the second heaven or the firmament, Psalm chapter 150, verse number 1. In fact, let's look at Psalm chapter 150, verse number 1. There we go. Praise the Lord. Praise God in his sanctuary. Praise him in his mighty firmament. So we see here that God created the second heaven for his honor, his purpose, and his glory. You see that there? God created the second heaven for his honor and his glory. But Satan wasn't happy roaming this earth, so he went to Ephesians 2:2, Ephesians 6:12. He went to the second heaven. Why? To see if he can interfere your prayers from reaching heaven. You remember what happened to Daniel. God heard his prayer from day one. He even fasted. He prayed and he wept. But it took him 21 days to receive his answer. And the mighty angel of the Lord said, we heard your prayer. God heard your prayer the first time. Folks, listen to me. God has heard your prayer the first time. The question is, are we penetrating? Is there a sound that comes out of us that pierces through the second heaven into the third? Now realize, we realize Christ lives in us. And we can just speak the word and it works. But sometimes there are hindering spirits. You sow, you give, you love, but you wonder, God, what's happening? What's happening? Well, many times that barrier called the second heaven, the devil is fighting like he fought against Daniel. And the word of the Lord came to Daniel, said, the Lord heard your prayer the first time, but Daniel prayed. He wept and he fasted, but it still took him 21 days. I'm here today to tell you, by the authority of the Lord Jesus Christ, it's not going to have to take you 21 days when you get the revelation, and you are getting the revelation, but you got to be recharged. You got to be plugged in, because the power of your prayers will penetrate that second heaven. Revelation, chapter 12, verse 7. This has happened in the past. This has happened in the past. This is happening now, and it will happen in the future. And that is this. And a war, somebody shout war.
War.
How many know we're in a war?
Yeah.
And a war broke out in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon and his angels fought. This is a verse that deals with the past. Satan fell out of heaven. It's happening now. Satan is the prince of power of the air, and it will happen again in the future, and then God's going to release the devil into the bottomless pit. What I'm telling you today is God wants to create a sound within his people. Not only recharging you spirit, soul, and body. Not only recharging you in every which way. Recharging your words. Matthew 8:8. The centurion. Jesus dealt with him. And he said, just speak the word. Lord, I'm not worthy that you should come under my roof. But speak the word, and my servant will be healed. I'm here today to tell you, God's recharging your words. Hear me, somebody. God's recharging your words. And the Lord said, I've never found such great faith in all of Israel. That's what happens when you recharge words. James chapter 3, verse 5 is a very interesting verse. James chapter 3, verse number 5 is a very, very interesting verse. Even so, the tongue is a little member and boasts great things. See how great a forest a little fire kindles. Now, God does not want us gossiping. You hear what I'm saying? But just the way this verse is used to say, do not gossip, let's reverse this now, and let's allow our tongue, our mouth, our words to create a fire. What I'm saying is when you speak God's word, you are recharging your life. You're recharging a fire of God within you by encouraging yourself and say, I will make it. I'm not going down. I am the head. I am not the tail. I can and I will. Your tongue needs to be, here's an R word for you. Here's an R word for you. Rekindle. So here's a, right out of the spiritual realm. Somebody shout rekindle.
Rekindle.
We haven't used that one before, have we?
No.
Come on, shout rekindle.
Rekindle.
Your words rekindle. But remember, back to what we just shared. There's a war in the heavenlies. And every seed you, today when you honor God with your tithes and offerings, the devil will try to intercept that. This word that I'm preaching today, the word that came last week and last Sunday and last Wednesday, the devil will try to hinder that. He'll try to put a wall, a barrier between your breakthrough. And we hear about joy and we become joyful for a moment. And suddenly we can lose our joy because the devil tries to steal, kill, and destroy. So I close with this. God wants to create a certain sound in us. What kind of sound? In 1 Corinthians, and this is where I close, in 1 Corinthians 14, verse number 7, and again, I prophesied these things to you, but now I'm giving you the addresses to these precious verses. Even things without life, whether flute or harp, when they make a sound, somebody say a sound. You see, every instrument produces a different sound. It's real simple. Every instrument produces a different sound. You want to hear the drums? Boom, ba ba bum. Keyboard, guitar. Every instrument produces a different sound. Hear me very carefully. Every sound you create does something in the atmospheric realm to where that second heaven has to say, I must get out of the way. I must get out of the way. Where according to Luke 11:24, you can put that on the screen. Where according to Luke 11:24, my sound that I make says that when that unclean spirit, that war in the heavenlies in the second heaven goes out of a man, he goes through the dry places seeking rest, but he finds none. He says, I will return to my house from which I came. Today I tell Encounter Church, I tell America, those of you watching, wherever you are, God's going to create in you a certain sound where every demonic force has to get out of the way, where your prayers don't have to take 21 days to be answered, where the prince and power of the air must rest in the dry places. Rest meaning tormented. Into the dry places. Not a good rest, but a rest that torments him. So we go back to 1 Corinthians 14, verse 7 and 8, and this is where we close. Even the things without life, whether flute, harp, when they make a sound, unless, Montalabuco, some of the guys come on up here. Follow me, guys, follow me. Look at me, guys. Unless they make, watch this, a distinction. Unless they make a distinction in the sounds. How will it be known what is piped or played?
Look at me, please. Some of us maybe are 50 years in the Lord. I don't question how long you've been in the Lord. I question is, how long have you been beating the drum of a wrong sound, following a different cadence, listening to a wrong sound in the spirit? A sound is not just a physical shout, although it's interesting that the Lord's going to return with the shout of heaven and the archangel of the Lord and the trumpet shall blast. But the Lord is looking for a distinct sound, but it requires a certain sound. We're not going to receive another offering today, but sometimes, hear me, God requires not an ordinary offering, but a certain offering. Cornelius offered a certain offering to the Lord, and it stopped heaven. Sometimes there's a certain word that you have to minister to somebody. Sometimes there's a certain word of encouragement to go out of your way. Sometimes there's a shout. Sometimes there's a roar. Sometimes it's weeping. Sometimes it's intercession. But sometimes you gotta, like on the radio dial, you gotta change the station, because your vibe attracts your tribe. And you gotta get in motion that which makes contact to where you know that's a word from God. Like that gentleman earlier who prophesied from the south side of Chicago, who, by the way, years ago lived on the streets of Chicago and was a drug addict. His sound, his vibe attracted my tribe. That was a sound for Encounter Church. That I would come back not just with a tan or refreshed in body, but a recharge for your life. And sometimes you can have a good sound, but is it the right sound? Sometimes we have to change the song. It was a good sound, but it has to be the right sound. And every day in your life, God wants to hear the right sound, because the right sound will pierce through the second heaven and it'll make a distinction. It'll make a difference. Maybe it's a new dance. Maybe it's a new shout. Maybe it's a new walk. Maybe it's a new place to sit in church. Maybe it's a different clap, a different kind of clap. I don't like white clapping. I don't like black clapping. I don't like Hispanic clapping. I don't like Asian clapping. I like a clap that gets heaven's attention. Not based on the color of my skin or the tradition of my church, but a certain sound at that very second that will get heaven's attention. Keep the verse up there. So it would be known what type of instrument it is. And verse number 8, and we're done. For if the trumpet makes an uncertain sound, who will prepare for battle? Folks, there's a sound from heaven coming to this house saying, prepare for battle. For you will defeat what has tried to defeat you. You will defeat, you will conquer that which has tried to conquer you through a certain sound. I have a friend of mine. He just started a church. What's the name of the church? Can we put that on the screen? See, this is, guys, this is all fresh. You remember Pastor Benny Hinn's praise and worship leader, Jim Sinero? That's him. That's Jim Sinero. Certain sound. Everything in life. See, Monday may always be Monday, but God's looking for a certain sound. Just because it's Monday, he may want a sound that sounds like Thursday. See, that throws off your schedule. See, God is notorious for throwing off your schedule. That's why we bring in different prophets and speakers, because they have a different sound. And we all add up to that same sound eventually to catch the atmospheric realm to bring us to a place we've never been. How about a certain sound? This has been the word of the Lord. Stand to your feet and give him a certain sound.
Yes.
Come on. Certain sound. A fresh, 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 fresh. Come on. Things old. He doesn't like things stale. He doesn't like an old atmosphere. Stinks like mothballs. God's a God of freshness. That's why he said, give us this day our daily bread. Fresh bread. When you start talking different, how you walked 5 years ago was good, but it's not going to get you to where you're going today. How you praised 5 years ago was good, but it's not going to get you where you're going to go tomorrow. Right now, we've been creating a sound that's lifting burdens from people's lives. Not only your life, but the life of loved ones. People that you don't even know, because the kingdom goes beyond this room. That certain sound is piercing the darkness, and it's giving us a fresh anointing. Certain sound. God's into fresh things. He's not an oldie. He may be old school, but he's not oldie. He likes new things. We like new clothes. We like new styles. God likes new styles. He's the Lord God. He changes not. But he likes new styles. Things are breaking right now in this atmosphere. So, one more time. Come on. Put your hands together or something. Do something different.
Certain style. Certain style.